The main purpose of this video is to save you money from yet another YouTube-induced mini cult and hype.
As far as I'm concerned, digital production and DCPs is the death of cinema as I know it.
I'm fed up with this conversation. I think it's what's in the frame. And
it always is.
It does nothing for me. I mean, I actually think I'm getting gypped when I go to a movie and I realize it's either been shot on digital or being projected in digital. I mean, some people feel differently about this, but I think it's the death keel. I think it's the death rattle. And
It's certainly got a lot of advantages that film never had, consistency being a really big one. It's about the eye behind the camera. It's not about the bloody technology.
I'm going to throw this in here to get done with this topic and a reminder again. It says here the Olympus is far more cleaner at high ISO than the Nikon D800. I don't know, I never had either camera. I made a video in the past about ugly bokeh transitions and high ISO values because most YouTubers are only gonna check the main subject in high ISO and they will ignore what happens in the background because high ISO is in-camera processing and the background is blurry to begin with and it's gonna turn really ugly sometimes in high ISO. Personally, I prefer to shoot at base ISO and use flash. I avoid high ISO as much as I can. In another more revealing video, a recent one, the shiny metals of this car under moderate ISO are not shiny anymore. And even with noise reduction, now they look like they're made out of a different material. No shiny metal anymore. So you gotta be careful with the ISO. A question arose from the previous video, would I ever go back to film? The answer is I would if digital had no advantages, but it has, and they are many. Another question was, what about CCDs? My answer would be yes and no. So this guy over here did a test, but that's not even a test. On the left we have CCD, on the right we have CMOS, but these are different cameras. When people saw the pictures, they ran on eBay to buy old digital cameras. And then he did another test. This time, two different cameras of the same brand though, same color science. And they were the same. CCD and CMOS. I think the argument is over here. It is what I have been saying all along, that your camera's color science, your shooting profiles, is number one. 2017, very narrow corridor and very dark, and I have my head stuck in the back of the wall to get as much picture in front of me as possible. And it's so dark that I can hardly focus. 12,800 ISO. And this is the image after editing that I would print. 16 by 20. It has a little bit of residual noise that I didn't want to further take away because this is not going to appear on the print anyway. And I just took this image with the iPhone to show you how it looks on the wall. It's an acrylic print. Same day I take this picture outside, I crop the bottom part, I upscale, I edit. And the final print is gigantic, specifically 21.6 by 39.3. I had an old frame with the exact dimensions. And I had removed some fringing that's here as well, and it's on my wall. None of these two prints would have been possible with film. And the smaller ones too. 5x7 that I was printing these, 2500 ISO, was very dark in there, and I was quite far too. Impossible with film. And then you're in a car exhibition. My daughter took this with a D500. And you have daylight balanced film, which is 5,000 Kelvin, but the light bulbs in there are 3,000 Kelvin. And on top of it, it's quite dark, quite darker than daylight. You're gonna do nothing. It's too dark for film. You're gonna sit back and wait. Unless you go to a film store in advance and you tell them, hi, I would like ISO 1000 film with a grain of a 400 film and balanced at 3000 Kelvin. I do not think that many people have appreciated the automatic color balancing of their digital cameras and the RAW file that will allow them to correct it regardless. You know, the good effect of film to the average user is that it forced people to use flash and to print. So now at least they have the pictures. But at the same time, it's got severe limitations. Requires a specific color temperature envelope, and every film has it on the box outside. No preview, no cropping unless you want your lab to start hating you, no RAW file, cameras with no multiple focus points, no corrections, and if you convert it to digital via scanner, then you're not in film land anymore. You have adapted digital color profiles. Would this image look better in film? This specific one is actually a prime candidate for good film photography. And there are quite a few films that would have taken this with more attractive colors, but you gotta be there specific hours of the day during which the color temperature agrees with the color temperature of the film where it is balanced. For portraits, on the other hand, I would go digital, no question. Digital with flash, of course, right? And these are the only corrections that I applied, obviously, for the print. Properly executed digital with flash, and for portraits, there is no substitute. In colors, in separation of colors, and overall balance of the scene. But if I were a professional photographer, and a client paid me lots of money for a unique flower photo, with richly saturated, spectacular colors, I would load up film. And I would also ask him to pay for special paper or special medium on which we will make the prints.
But capturing the images is just one part of the process. Burkett is one of a handful of photographers printing from color transparency film onto a now discontinued paper called Cibachrome.
And it's the only paper that was ever made that had the dyes in the paper when it was made. The processing takes away all the unwanted dye, and you're left with the image itself, which is completely stable because there's no chemical residue in there. There's just dyes in the paper.
Cibachrome was first sold in the 1960s. As photography shifted from using analog film to digital image sensors, many professional photographers abandoned the technique, but Burkett continued to embrace it. In 2011, when the company stopped making Cibachrome, Burkett bought a 10-year supply of the paper.
It's amazing that everything is in focus. It's like you're bringing us there. How do you get that depth where it's, I can, you know, see the bottom of the water there?
Cibachrome has that depth to the image where I don't think any other print material would have that kind of, not just luminosity, but almost seems physically deep, you know. I've had people at gallery openings even kind of go like this to make sure you haven't glued something on the top of the print.
These days, Burkett spends most of his time focused on printing in his studio. He walked us through the elaborate process. One step is called masking.
We make a black and white negative that this is going to be sandwiched with this, and this is going to determine the overall contrast of the print.
Then he adjusts the color.
When you get exactly the right color balance, and then even the slight opposite colors, let's say in the veins of green on a green leaf, will start to pop, you might say, or become more luminous.
And that's when you know you've got it.
Yeah, that's when you know you have it.
But it's the next step that Burkett says is the most crucial.
So the light is being projected onto the paper. I'm withholding light by my dodging tools, which is going to darken those areas. And I have to keep the items moving to get a smooth edge so there's no evidence of the darkening of little bright areas.
The process is then reversed with a tool that allows in more light and brightens certain areas of the image.
And then I will ask the client to change his curtains to white and paint his walls light gray and change his light bulbs to natural light. Otherwise, the prints are not going to look that good. So you see what kind of a rabbit hole this is. And if his wife is wearing too much makeup, I will ask him to divorce her because she messes up the color balance in the room. At any rate, I'm not going back to film. For what I do, it is very inflexible, very limited. Unless one day I get something very specific in mind that only film can produce, and somehow I have the time and the means to complete it. And I'm not going to be chasing CCD sensors because all the money has been thrown to CMOS sensor applications, and the overall package today of a CMOS sensor is much better than the old aging electronics in the CCD sensor setups. For now, this is just another stupid YouTube hype. But I may shoot a roll of film with my daughter just so that she has the experience, because a new generation thinks it's quite cool. The most important thing nowadays, and not many people have the time to do that, is to get used to the equipment to the point that it's out of the way, like driving your car second nature. And you cannot do that if you change cameras and lenses all the time. As a matter of fact, as time goes by, I've been reducing my equipment and focusing on prints, albums, and storage. Thanks a lot. Bye.